from Los Angeles, this is Right About Now.
Right About Now. Right About Now. The Funk Soul Brother.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to the Right About Now podcast. It's John Small, and I am so happy you're joining me today. We have a really interesting guest. Katherine May is here, and Katherine is a writer in the UK who writes just beautiful prose. She has several books out, a memoir, nonfiction, and the book we're going to talk about today is one that's causing quite a stir on both sides of the Atlantic, and it is a book called Wintering. And it's almost hard to explain what it is. It's sort of part memoir, part instructional guide to life. But Katherine talks about those times in our lives when unforeseen circumstances, such as the death of a loved one, or the loss of a job, or, I don't know, COVID-19, come and just completely shake up and derail your life. And that sort of feeling of dislocation that we feel, she calls that wintering. And rather than trying to run away from that feeling, Katherine is all about embracing it and understanding it and realizing that it's just as much a part of life as being happy and fulfilled and content. And there is a power in embracing that sadness and those spaces in between. And that's what wintering is all about, and that's what we talk about. She's got a fascinating life story. Not only does she write the talk, but she walks the walk. Is that how you say it? I don't know. But the point is that she lives what she writes about. And in fact, as she was writing Wintering, her life started to sort of collapse. And she will talk about that and how she coped with it. And she just happened to be writing this book about what she was actually going through in that moment. She gives me some really handy tips on how to deal with those kind of feelings of sadness that kind of creep up in your life, even if you don't live in a wintry place. I mean, I live in Los Angeles, it's 82 degrees today in the middle of February, but that's not really what we're talking about here. We're talking about wintering as sort of a state of mind. And we all go through it, let's face it. We all have those moments of sadness and doubt. This is a wonderful, wonderful meditation on getting through those periods in a way that is healthy and helpful. So I am excited to bring you Katherine May. I might even take her class. This was a really beneficial podcast for me in many ways. I might have met my new writing instructor. So without further ado, I bring you my interview with the lovely and talented Katherine May. Well, Katherine May, welcome to the Right About Now podcast.
Thank you so much for having me. It's exciting to be here.
I am so excited to have you. What a beautiful book. You are just such a gifted writer, and it was just a pleasure to read. People have said it's very meditative, and I agree. It's sort of like a nice respite during these crazy times to read a book that kind of lets you relax and not feel so anxious. But I think it would be great.
Nice to hear.
Yeah, I think it would be great. Let's just set the stage here. If you could define wintering for our audience, what you mean by wintering?
So wintering is a time in life when we fall through the cracks. So it could come for any number of reasons. I mean, we've ended up talking about it a lot in terms of the pandemic this year. But of course, when I wrote it, I didn't know anything about the pandemic.
Right.
So, you know, it often comes after a bout of mental or physical illness, after a big life change or life event, you know, like a divorce, the loss of a job. A bereavement is a really common thing that sends us into a wintering period. But the point is that all of these different experiences lead us to a similar space in life, which is this feeling that we have failed, that we've been humiliated, that we're cut off or isolated. And what I say is that however it arrives, it's always painful and always really difficult to cope with. But it's also a time of great transformation and change. And if we can learn to accept our winters and to kind of walk with them rather than to fight them, then we have half a hope of surviving them better and coming out the other side with greater insight, I think. Does that summarize it okay?
I think it's perfect. And it does. It means that you don't have to live in a place where there's actually winter. Although sometimes these seasonal, we were just talking before we got on that you're there in chilly England and I'm here in balmy LA, but it doesn't matter. Winter follows me here to what you're talking about, because it doesn't have to do with the weather, although the weather certainly helps. But this was all inspired by your own personal experience, right? This thought of wintering and diving into this topic. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah. So I wanted to write the book because I felt like in some ways I was an expert winterer, if such a thing is possible. I felt like I'd endured more winters than most, or at least as many as anyone. You know, I'd started experiencing bouts of depression when I was young. I had bouts of ill health that took me out of jobs and out of school for a while. You know, I've been through the ringer, I suppose, and I wanted to be able to share that experience. I felt like I could write from a position of knowledge. But what I didn't realize is that while I was writing the book, I'd go through another wintering phase that I wasn't expecting. And that took me completely by surprise. And so I ended up writing about what I was going through at the time, along with the other stuff that I'd always meant to put in the book, like the folklore of winter and the philosophy and the psychology of it. But I'd already decided to leave my job by that point. I'd handed in my notice, but suddenly my husband became very ill in a very life-threatening way. Mm. And then I became ill. And I dropped into this space of feeling like mortality had visited me, I think, my family. And, you know, it was a really difficult period. It was a very difficult period to write a book in. But I think what it meant is that I was showing the encounter with winter as I walked through it, rather than looking at it from a distance. And, in a lot of ways that helped.
So that's interesting. So you had already had the concept for this book, and you were writing it, and then all these things started happening to you in your personal life that were just reinforcing.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
Yeah, it was funny. I mean, I really thought that I could write a book from the kind of sunny uplands. You know, I could look back over winters that I had experienced, and like I hoped that I could sort of hand out advice in a really sage way. But life had other plans, and probably quite rightly. So instead, I ended up, you know, writing an account of a winter. And what that meant for the book was that I was writing about some of the more complex experiences of going through a wintering that maybe I would have missed out if I hadn't have been enduring it at the time. So I wrote about, you know, the paranoia, the kind of raging hunger, the anger, all of those things, which I think makes the book more immediate and more human. And I'm glad they're there, actually. It's more truthful.
Where did you come up with this word wintering? Is it a kind of the opposite of summering? I think we use that expression. I don't know if you use that expression in the UK, but we say summering.
Oh. No, well, actually, wintering is a word that's used in nature a lot, you know, to describe the way that birds in particular, we use it most for birds, about where they winter. So after a bird has migrated, they choose where they winter because they try and find somewhere a bit warmer. I get a lot of wintering birds in Whitstable, funnily enough. We have all kinds of different birds that come to winter here. So that's, you know, it's a familiar word for me. And I also knew it from Sylvia Plath's poem, Wintering, which is in Ariel. So the word was already in my head and I'd always liked it, but I only made the connection very late between that state of being that I wanted to describe and this word that seemed so to have its own potency, I think.
I love that you embrace this idea that it's okay to be sad, that there's actually an importance in being sad and kind of resting with it. Because I think we live in a culture where it's all about being happy all the time, right? That's like everybody's aspiring to be happier. And we all know that that's an impossible state to achieve on a consistent basis, that sadness is as much a part of life as happiness. And I remember my father, before he passed away, I remember him having this realization and telling me, you know, there's nothing wrong with being sad, because I was so sad that he was sick. And he said, you know, there's nothing wrong with being sad. I'm starting to realize that being sad is just part of life, just as important as being happy. But we run from sadness, right? So how does one sort of embrace that feeling of winter, that sort of devastating feeling that nothing is going right and, oh my God, my life is falling apart? How do you use that in a way It's sort of funny because I'm almost saying, like, how do you make yourself happy being sad?
how do you find a state of contentment in
exactly,
your sadness?
Exactly, in sadness.
Yeah, there's no easy answer to that, actually. I mean, you know, it's a long, slow process of learning and it's a practice. You know, you have to keep returning to these ideas over and over again in order to gain an acceptance of them. Like, there's no one thing you can do that will make sadness somehow seem like a good idea for you. And, you know, it will always be unpleasant. But I think on a basic level, we can accept that sadness is normal, it's ordinary, it's not a failure, it's not the same as, you know, being ill, it's not a dysfunction. It's actually something that's really functional to us. It's something that is offering us an insight. It's, you know, it's telling us that something's going wrong. And, you know, like you've given a lovely example there that, you know, your father dying is sad. It's, you know, there's no way
there's
in
no
which
way around
that,
it, yeah.
Yeah, there's no way around that. But also, that's the right thing to feel about that. Of course it's sad. And yet so many of us would try and avoid that sadness. You know, we'd hide it under anger, or we'd throw ourselves into work to try not to feel it at all, or we'd drink heavily, for example. You know, there's a lot of addictions are formed around people trying to avoid those difficult feelings. And in fact, after a while, if you can bear to bury into your sadness, to find a way to really encounter it, you find that sadness is not the most difficult emotion. Avoiding sadness is much harder than actually being sad. And there's actually a purity in sadness and a beauty in sadness that you can find. It's okay.
That's beautiful. You mentioned that you, or in your book, you write about your own childhood. And you mentioned earlier in this interview that you have gone through different periods of wintering your whole life. Tell us a little bit about your origin story. I know you grew up
like a sci-fi.
Yeah, exactly. Katherine May origin story. Before you became the superhero of wintering with a big W on your cape. Where did you come from, and what was your childhood like?
Yeah, so I grew up in a town called Gravesend in the southeast of England, a very kind of working class environment. Like, my parents divorced when I was young and we lived in state housing. We were quite hard up. But also I was one of the many, many women of my age who went undiagnosed with autism. So I kind of grew up thinking that I was a wonky kind of a human being, that I knew I was different to the people around me, but there was no way for me to describe that or to make an account of it. And so instead, I felt like I was just wrong. And I felt like there would be an answer for me at some point in life, like a change or an adaptation that I could make that would mean that I coped better with the world around me. And, you know, that never came, because it couldn't come. there's no way around it. And that, you know, what that led me to was loads of different mental health problems, you know, depression, anxiety. I suffered from an eating disorder and also big, big crashes in my physical health too. It's really common for autistic people, particularly people who are like masking really heavily and trying to be like everybody else, to experience burnout, which is a huge physical event, actually. It's, you know, it's an experience of total exhaustion, physical pain, mind fog, you know, pretty similar to the way people are describing long COVID, actually.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I had those issues coming up throughout my life and at pretty regular intervals, because every time I got better, I would go back to trying to be a neurotypical person again, and I'd go back into a full-time job and I would get exhausted and stop coping again and then crash out. And I didn't break that cycle until I was 38 and I finally got identified as autistic. And that was the subject of my last memoir. I wrote about that experience of learning, you know, what it meant to be me, actually, and how to meet my own needs. And so that, I think that, you know, you're going to be able to tell that I'm quite an optimistic soul. You know, my interpretation of that, I guess, was to say, okay, well, how can I use this to help other people? Because I've learned an awful lot about those times out of life. And I feel like I can be a guide to it. And I feel like I can be part of normalizing that, because I have always been able to see that happening across so many different people and for such a lot of reasons. And part of my autistic nature is I'm not really afraid to state the truth. You know, I'm not someone who is very keen on small talk. I will always want to talk about the big things. And I find it very hard not to talk about these massive issues that affect us, but which we all are supposed to ignore out of politeness. And so I guess, you know, that's the origin myth of the book and of me kind of together, really intertwined.
Is that part of autism? How does your autism manifest itself in your experience? You mentioned that you almost don't have those social cues, right? That some people have about things you're not supposed to talk to, things you're supposed to talk about. In the autistic people I know sometimes don't have that filter. Is that a way that it manifests itself in your own experience?
Yeah, I mean, my experience of it is, you know, mostly about kind of sensory overwhelm, actually. Mm-hmm. I think that's a really hidden part of the autistic experience, that we're often very overwhelmed. Like, you know, my touch, my smell, my sense of sound are all turned up to 500. And so I'm often kind of trying to deal with a world in which I feel bombarded by sensory input, but I'm having to act like everybody else, like nothing's happening. But yeah, there's an interesting... It's quite hard to explain, but I think most autistic people I know find it very hard to not want to talk about the truth all the time. Like, we are we're the blurters, certainly, but also we don't see the point in small talk. We don't really understand why people are so invested in keeping so much of human experience quiet. And I, you know, like, that's often interpreted as like not understanding social norms. I think we do, actually. I think we're often experts in social norms. I think we study them very hard because we have to learn them in order to get through. But actually, maybe we don't want to follow them. We don't see the same value in them that the rest of society sees. And we, you know, feel very keenly this silence around some of the difficult parts of life. And we tend to want to externalize them.
Yeah.
I think that's very true of me.
Yeah. Do you think that's what led you to wanting to be a writer, to be able to have the power of the pen to sort of express what you see and what you want to say?
I think I was born a writer, actually. Writing wasn't ever a choice for me. I was always wanting to make words. I love words. I'm really passionate about them. I really enjoy the way they feel. Yeah. And, you know, like, one of my earliest memories is sitting down and writing, pretend join up writing before I could even write, you know, writing pages and pages as if I was writing.
Oh, that's cute.
And I was I was so desperate to do it. And I, you know, I learned to read early. I learned to write very quickly. Yeah,
Was there anybody else in your family that was a writer, or was that just something that you were born, you just had this?
No.
No, not at all.
No, not at all, actually. It's funny. I mean, you know, I don't come from a particularly educated background, actually. Like, my mum was always very keen on me to have a good education, but I didn't really have any role models for that. It was something, you know, like, I always had this relationship with language that had to be expressed. And, you know, I started saying very early that I was going to be a writer. And then in my teens, I got embarrassed about it for a while. And, you know, pretended to myself that I didn't want to be a writer. But in my mid-20s, I had to admit that, no, that dream had never died. And I started working on it seriously.
And you write both fiction and nonfiction. You've written memoirs, like you said. Fiction. Is there, it's interesting to go between the two. Is there one that you tend to be drawn more to?
I think I'm more of a reader of nonfiction than fiction, actually. Mm-hmm. I think that's where my true passion lies in lots of ways. But what I really love is having both. In fact, I really love being able to switch between the two. It feels like a rest. So when I've completed a sort of cycle with the nonfiction, while I'm still feeling quite depleted by that and tired and empty, it really helps me to then switch on to writing some fiction. And often, like, the fiction ideas will start knocking on my door at just that point, you know?
Yeah. And it's always what you're really not working on.
Yeah. It feels a bit like a flirtation in some ways.
Right.
You know, you have an affair with the book that you're not supposed to be writing. But I think that's really part. I used to think that was terrible that I did that and that I was this, you know, terribly uncommitted writer. But I think actually that's a really fundamental part of my process. And I think it helps because it lets me take a break. a mental break, you know, and writing is such an intense thing to do. It takes so much passion and commitment, and whatever you're writing takes over your whole brain. And I think every now and again, my brain just dives out and goes, nope, let's do something else.
Yeah.
And some of my best, a lot of my best work has come from the book that's the affair that I'm having, from the book I thought I was supposed to be writing.
That's so interesting. So is it a different book? Because that happens to me too, where I'm writing something and I'm like, God, I really want to be writing this other thing. It's like my passion project, but I'm working on the thing that I started. I'm like, I have to finish the thing that I started. But there's like, oh, but I really want to write that. And is it the thing, is that, but I really want to write that, the book that ends up being the book, or is it the same book?
You know what? It just varies so much. I mean, like this year, I've been supposed to be writing my next nonfiction, and all I can think about is a novel that I want to write. And I guarantee to you that if I switched over onto writing that novel, I would quickly crave my nonfiction again. You know? Yeah, the grass is always greener. And sometimes I think you end up creating the book that someone is prepared to commission, honestly. Like, I'm very practical about those things.
Of course.
But it can be really hard to force your brain to think about things that it's not fully committed to, can't it? Sometimes it does feel a bit like you're trying to fit yourself into the wrong shaped hole. Mm-hmm. And I often just indulge my weird writing desires. And quite often they go away very quickly if I just let them happen for a few days. I'll happily then go back to my main text.
Do you have a writing process? Do you sort of do the same thing every day, a ritual? When you get up in the morning to write, is there a time that you write every day? Like, what's your process?
I'm quite random, actually. Mm-hmm. I have to say, I know loads of writers who've got a really clear process, and I'm always slightly envious of that.
Me too.
I write best early in the morning, I think. Although as soon as I say that, I'll have a craving to write in the middle of the night. I think part of my practice is to switch locations. I get very bored and fidgety. So I quite like to write on the kitchen table or on the sofa. And, pandemics allowing, I like to really, really like to write in cafes. Mm-hmm. And libraries. I love writing in libraries. There's something about them, the quality of attention.
You're surrounded by books. Yeah, like great, all these great books. Yeah, I know, that's powerful. I like writing in bookstores too. If they let.
Oh, yeah, you can't really do that in our country. Do you know what? That opportunity doesn't really present itself. There's not many bookstores.
We have these little Barnes and Nobles that have cafes in them. So yeah, I like to write in bookstores, but those were the days. Nice. I haven't written in a bookstore.
Yes.
Over
a while ago, you liked to write in bookstores.
Yeah. LA, it's weird because everybody's writing a screenplay and I'm not writing the screenplay. So everybody's there writing their screenplays. You see all these screenplays. But it is
fun. That's
nice.
That makes you special and unique. That's good. You should cling to that. Definitely.
I should use that to get through my wintering. When is writing a form of therapy for you? Like when you have your wintering moments, periods, does writing help you kind of focus? And
sometimes. I mean, I think often they're the times when I find it hardest to write. But what I do find useful is having a notebook that I will never, ever show anyone the contents of. And that means that I can fill that notebook with, moaning mostly. I don't put myself under any pressure to make any great art in my notebook. Like it's really there for me to go, oh, I can't write today and my head's all fuzzy and I feel really anxious and I'm so frustrated. And if anyone researches my archive in the future, which will not happen because I will leave instructions to burn, they would only encounter loads of me moaning.
Right. Yeah. Anybody says they just enjoy writing is not totally entitled.
It's horrible.
It's a horrible,
bloody dreadful thing to do with your time. Honestly, I don't know why we do it. It's just
why would anybody choose to do it? I know. It's like you said, sometimes you just have to.
Yeah. I mean, if I had a choice, I would do a job that earned me consistent money and made me feel safe and contented. However, I appear to be a writer.
You've chosen this life. One of the things you do that's so interesting is that it's not just your own experience you talk about in the context of wintering. You also weave in the things that you've learned through science and different cultures. What were some of the surprising things that you found when you kind of took a more of a deep dive into wintering within other cultures? What was something that you learned about how other cultures have coped with this phenomenon?
Yeah, so I was really interested to find out about the kind of Scandinavian cultures around winter. Mm. And, I knew that those people would be able to tell me something about what it was like to be close to proper deep winter with, deep snow and being cut off and all of those kind of experiences that are really alien to me. And, you know, I mean, I think it comes across in your country as well. We have this idea in the UK that Scandinavians are, you know, they're living in this kind of utopia. They're more happy than we mm-hmm. are. They have this very cozy life. Everything's very hygge, you know, and they've got everything right.
Because they always come up on the list of like most contented people. It's always the Scandinavian countries, right? And those like polls. Yeah. So it seems like they're doing something right.
It does. But then when you look at it, they also come up on the lists of the highest suicide rates mm-hmm. as well, and the highest levels of alcoholism and domestic abuse and depression. And when you start talking to people from the far north about what their life is like, they will sort of tell you that, yes, they do burrow into hygge culture. They do make their house cozy. They do all they can to make winter enjoyable. But that's because they really know how hard and painful winter can be. And it's not that everything's perfect. It's that everything is so hard that they have to find a way through. And that's a really, I think it's a different kind of an insight to the way we talk about it. You know, it's not that they get it right. It's just that they make this massive effort to correct how wrong it can be when you're stuck in a, you know, the dark and the cold for months at a time without any hope of a thaw or without being able to escape your family who are driving you crazy. They have a culture that corrects that. It's slightly different. And that was an interesting insight for me, because that's all about acceptance of difficulty rather than getting it right in the first place, which is, you know, part of the message of the book.
Yeah. I'm trying to think of how you would translate that into your normal life, into your, how can you adapt the Scandinavian way into your life? Well, you know, is it being prepping for winter, although we never know when it's going to come. I mean, we never know when a loved one's going to die, or we're just going to get a bout of sadness for whatever reason, get a midlife crisis or whatever it is. But I wonder, yeah, is there anything that we can learn from the way the Scandinavians, aside from their high suicide rate?
Let's never learn that.
Right, bad lesson.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we can't prep for winter in the way that Scandinavians do it. You know, it doesn't come to us so regularly. Mm-hmm. But what we can do is accept, genuinely accept that a winter will come. You know, we can, when we're feeling happy, when everything's going okay, we can know that there'll be another time when it's harder. And that may sound like a really negative thing to do and undesirable, but actually it helps, because it doesn't come as such a surprise to us when, you know, when things don't go so well. And I, you know, for me, that's the radical accepting of winter that we need to do. But also what they're brilliant at is finding like ways to achieve joy, even when things are awful. So I spent a lot of time investigating sauna culture. You know, we say sauna, they say sauna.
They do sauna.
And yeah, they say sauna, which is lovely. So I'm going with that, because okay, it sounds really authentic. Yeah. But I mean, so we see having a sauna as like this luxury activity that is, you know, part of a spa day, and it's really nice. In Finland, they see having a sauna, having access to a sauna, as like a basic human right. I mean, the way Hannah, who I interviewed about it, described it is, you know, it's as necessary as a bathroom. Mm-hmm. And even if you live in a block of flats, you'll have access to a shared sauna that you'll have like a certain slot every week when you can use it. And that creates, particularly in midwinter, it creates like a change of environment, a different mindset, a specialness, I guess, in the day, when people can, you know, relax together and take a break and enter a more contemplative mindset where they talk through their feelings and their problems and try and solve, you know, whatever life is throwing at them. And that, like, obviously, you know, we're not all going to install a sauna.
I'm about to call my contractor and get a sauna.
That's right. You've got to be in sauna.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it's, you know, maybe that's not going to happen. Maybe it will. Who knows? Perhaps I'll start a sauna revolution.
It could be a huge thing, but it is a wonderful, I think of, you know, I lived in Japan for a year and they had these bathhouses, which are kind of a similar thing it's like, they're so obsessed with, not obsessed, but the Japanese do these.
It's their thing.
These communal bathhouses, which seem kind of odd to us Westerners, but there was something, even though they don't really talk that much in the bath. It's kind of like more of a, but it's just a place where everybody kind of gathers and it like chills.
Yeah.
And yeah. And, yeah, they're onto something with
that. The message is, yeah, it's seeking joy. It's seeking pleasure very deliberately when maybe pleasure isn't, you know, available in a simple, straightforward way. And I think we can learn such a lot from that. I think we have been learning that skill in lockdown, actually. I think we've been learning to find nice things to do to help our way through it, because otherwise it's just impossible, isn't it?
Yeah. And not feeling guilty about it. I mean, that was one thing that you brought up in your book, is that, like, I think there's this culture right now, if we're not busy or doing something or constantly being productive, then there's this kind of shame that comes with that. Like, almost like, oh my God, I find myself all day sort of saying like, oh, I got to get back to work. What am I doing? You know, kind of like chastising myself. And there is some beauty. It's one of the reasons I've been trying to get into meditation too, because there's some power in just finding what to do with, like you said, in those spaces in between. And not even finding something to do. Like, you don't have to be busy. Like, there's power in resting, right? I mean, like, there's nothing wrong with resting.
And, you know, if you had a friend who was exhausted, you would tell them to rest and you would believe in that. But for some reason, we find it very hard to give ourselves the same advice. But we do need to rest. And, like, if we don't make space in our life for anything, if we keep on rushing between, you know, different events and different tasks, we never get the chance to think. And actually, I mean, I'm a meditator. I've been a meditator for a long time now. And I guess what that does for you is it makes a space for you to reflect. Like and it makes it seem like an activity, even though it's just sitting still. And we need that. We need to find the way that we allow ourselves to stop. Because there's so many insights that you're denying yourself if you're never stopping. There's so much that you learn just from sitting still and just from, like, listening to yourself, listening to what's going on in your mind at the time, finding out what's concerning you, finding out what's exciting you and what's thrilling you and what's scaring you. You know, all of those things, we can so easily ignore them. And it's about making space somehow, whatever way appeals to you, I think.
And to observe them. And tell me a little bit about your meditation practice. How often do you meditate?
I used to meditate very formally. Like, I learned to meditate 20 minutes twice a day. After I had my son, full disclosure, I found that amazing. It was life-changing for me. Yeah. But after I had my son, it just wasn't possible to do it. And since then, I'm an opportunistic meditator now. I would love to still find those 20 minutes twice a day, but that's not going to come to me for a few years. But I find moments to drop into meditation. So sometimes that's just 5 minutes of pause. Sometimes it's a few seconds of shifting my attention onto my body and onto what I'm feeling. And sometimes I do it for an hour, So I'm much more freeform now. And like, I wake up in the middle of the night a lot, and that's a great time to meditate because even the dog's asleep, so it can't leap out at me and lick my face all of a sudden, which is like my most hated meditation thing to happen at the moment. The dog's like, oh, she's sitting still, I'm gonna lick her.
My cat,
she won't normally let me lick her.
You're like, go away.
I was trying to have a spiritual moment, guys. So I think it helps that I had that, those few years of practice under my belt that helps me to drop into that state.
Did you take classes, or are you sort of a self-taught meditator?
No, I trained with TM. I learned to do TM. And then after about a year, I realized I was quite uncomfortable with how rigid that was and how kind of fixed the rules were. And so I read around and tried to alter it myself. And I ended up doing some work with a meditation teacher called Lauren Roche, who I think he doesn't live too far from you, actually.
They're all here in the West Coast.
Absolutely. Yeah, damn right they are. Yeah, and so I worked with him to just completely break apart what meditation actually meant and how I could access it in loads of different ways. And that's what set me up for lifelong meditation was, being able to do it my way according to my whim on the day. And that was, that was the really powerful moment for me, I think.
What are some other things you do? Because to deal with these wintering moments, and I'd love to just know your own practice because meditation is really interesting. Do you take walks? I find I have all this time. I mean, I shouldn't say I have a lull time. I'm busy and I'm working harder than I've ever worked in my life right now. But when I do have those free moments, sometimes I don't know what to do with them. Like, I'm like, kind of like, should I read a book? Should I meditate? It's like this weird panic thing where I'm like, I have too much free time. And I'm curious.
You could just sit and have a cup of tea and you'd be fine.
It's true. Why can't I just sit? I feel like I've got to get to that place where I could have a cup of tea and sit on the deck and look at nature and just feel like that's fine. That's helping.
I think I'd recommend that for you. I think you should learn to just have a cup of tea in those moments. It's a
I
good
should.
Thing to do.
Maybe that's why I love watching English dramas, because they always have a cup of tea.
Tea.
Always.
You see, it's the power of tea. I've got all sorts
You're
of
You're onto something.
About
that is a ritual.
Yeah.
That is a ritual.
Yeah, yeah,
we don't have rituals like that in America, at least not where I live.
No.
We don't really have.
Well, it's dying off here, you know, because everyone makes their tea with tea bags now, you know, instead of making it in a pot. But I still make tea with tea leaves in a pot. And that means that I have to wait for 5 minutes for it to brew. And that's a really particular pause in your day while you're waiting for your tea to be ready. You know?
Yeah, that's nice.
All of those little moments are really useful. But yeah, I'm a big walker. I love walking. I got the dog so that I would absolutely have to walk every day. But when I can, I take a really long walk that lasts hours. And I adore those moments. I think there's something about that third hour of walking when you're tired and you've run through all the kind of conscious thoughts and your brain kind of empties itself spontaneously. I love that space. I really crave it. I don't get it nearly enough.
Yeah, I find when I read about some of the great thinkers, they're big walkers. There's something about walking, I think, that enables you to think in a certain way, or they say they have their best ideas while they're walking. Do you walk? Do you listen to music, or are you very much about?
No.
No way. Yeah.
No, and actually, it's really interesting because I my last book, I walked the Southwest Coast Path, and you know, it's a really difficult, rugged path, and it took me a long time. And people sort of said to me, "Oh, you must listen to to music while you're doing it, or do you listen to podcasts?" You know,
exactly.
And it's like, no,
I listened to your book.
If I was doing that, did you?
Well, I listened to your
right,
book.
Stop doing that. It's okay. Really bad for you.
Okay.
But it's really funny, isn't it? Like we find it really hard to just walk without any input. And the sounds of nature, I know this is a cliche, but they are very beautiful. And there's a lot to still listen to without inputting. And it can become about productivity, can't it? It can become about like, right, okay, so I'm walking. So actually, if I listen to this podcast at the same time, then I'm going to learn a bit about this. And so that gets me ready for the next thing. Or if I listen to this audiobook, then I'm going to feel a bit more up to date about what novels are out at the moment. You know, no. I do not listen to anything while I'm walking. Even if I'm walking for 8 hours, I am there on my own with my thoughts. And if that's difficult, then that's a real sign that it's time to train yourself to do that. You might want to do that gradually, but we need to learn to be alone with our thoughts. They are important to us. They're telling us stuff that we need to know.
Do you write your thoughts down during your walk? Do you ever have like, oh, I've got to write that down. That's a good one.
I use a voice recorder, actually. Yeah, quite often I think, oh, I can't lose this.
Because you will lose it.
But it will go. It will really go. I actually, while I was walking the Southwest Coast Path, I took part in some research that a friend of mine was doing. He's a psychologist and he was trying to dig into creative thinking. And so I agreed to record my thoughts at sort of fixed intervals during the walk. And I mean, God knows what he thought of it when he received the recordings, but there was all kinds of crazy, associative bubbling up of ideas for a couple of hours and then just complete silence after a while.
Oh, that's interesting.
But I rarely remembered anything that I'd thought, but the process was really important and felt very exciting to me at the time. Like quite often when I was making the recordings, I was doing so in some sort of state of excitement, like I'd figured everything out and like, I've got to get this down. And then you listen back afterwards and you're like, that is gibberish. What were you thinking?
That almost reminds me of when you try to write down your dreams. You wake up from a dream, you're like, that was the best dream. You know, and if you remember it,
so
you're like,
similar.
And then you write it down and you're like, what? That made no sense. It was so great in the dream. It was like the best joke you've ever told, or I don't know what that is. It's like a subconscious talking to you or
composed
something.
Composed a song in my... It's funny that though, isn't it? Because it just goes to show that we enter these altered states that we don't think we do, but actually being us is really variable, you know? And yeah, I mean, honestly, God knows where those recordings are, and he might use them to bribe me one day. But yeah, they are hilarious.
Let's talk. So you have a son, and he's in your book. How old is your son?
He's 8.
He's 8. Okay, I have an 11-year-old daughter. But you took him out of school, talk to me a little about, because we talked about this a little bit in the beginning of the interview, the idea of that you wanted to teach him to be more resilient. And do you mind? I think that's such good advice for parents who are listening. What you learned about yourself.
Yeah. Well, I never thought I'd be the person that took my son out of school. Like, it was never my ambition to be a homeschooler. Yeah. I always thought that the people that did it were like magical beings who had much more patience and tolerance than me. I never thought that.
Or my crazy neighbor who has her 3 triplets out of school and is teaching them to be in a rock band. They're like the Partridge Family next door. Sorry if she's listening.
Oh, wow. You've got like Hanson living next door or something.
He is. I love my neighbor just in case she's listening. Yeah.
Worth saying. Yeah. So it became really clear to us that our son was struggling to cope with school. He was just completely overwhelmed and stressed. And, you know, like, the standard advice is to force them through it, really, to tell them that they have to just get on with it. And I realized that I couldn't do that in all conscience, and that I didn't want to do that. And so, and I, you know, like, at the same time, I really didn't want to lose my nice quiet daytimes when I write, you know, when my son was at school. But it was really important for me to pull him out of school at that point and to talk to him about, you know, how he's going through a difficult time and how, you know, he's sad at the moment and how we're going to work through it together. And I really learned to listen to him in that moment. It was a very important moment for me, because I found levels of resilience that I didn't think I had while I was teaching him to find levels of resilience too. And I think ultimately, I hope that what he learned from that in the future is that his feelings matter and his mental health really matters. And I hope he'll continue to look after himself into adulthood rather than to squash down difficult emotions.
That's beautiful. Is he, are you going to put him back in school or?
He's back. Yeah.
Oh, he is back. Okay.
I mean, it's really interesting because everyone, you know, there were a lot of doomsayers who said, well, if you take him out, he'll never go back in again. And that's your lot, you know. No, he came out of school for 9 months, and we found a better school that were kinder and that cared about him as an individual rather than how he conformed to the way they thought he should, you know, do and be and feel. And he's been really happy there. Really, really happy. And so actually, you know, it is possible to go through a cycle of healing and come out the other side. Nothing's permanent.
That's the lesson of wintering. Winter ends.
Yes, it does. It ends. Spring comes eventually. It thaws. Yeah.
Your final advice here, I love, you know, you're such a wonderful writer. And for a lot of my listeners or aspiring writers or maybe writers that are looking for a little inspiration, what can you tell people? What advice do you give to writers aside from, you have to just keep writing, which a lot of writers tell writers to do. You got to write if you want to be a writer. But what is maybe something that you learned about writing early on that helps you get through it?
You know what? I think it's to ignore all writing advice, to be honest. You know, there's so many people out there who give such stringent writing advice. Like, this is the system that you follow. Like, this is how you do it. Like, yeah, you've got to write every day. You've got to have a routine. You've got to get down 1,000 words every day, blah, blah, blah. I mean, I've never followed any of those rules. My practice is really variable and always has been. And sometimes I don't write at all. And sometimes I write loads. And, you know, all of it works. It's a long life and you can afford some variation. But the most important thing is to tune into your way of writing and to figure out what that is. And to work with that rather than paying any attention to all the people who will tell you they've got it figured out, because they probably haven't. And I say this as someone that runs writing courses, you know, don't listen to my advice.
Really, class? Can people take a Katherine?
Yeah.
That's
wonderful. You can. Yeah. I have a wintering for writers course, actually, for writers who are stuck. That's a self-directed course. So that's like a really lovely reflective healing kind of a course. And also I run, you know, maybe twice a year, I run a deep dive into creative nonfiction writing called Writing Your True Story. And it's really about how to conceptualize your nonfiction story, particularly if you're writing memoir. Yeah, teaching's always been a really key part of my practice, actually. It's how I learn. And I love doing it. Yeah.
I might have to take your memoir course. Is it how?
Oh, so you must.
I must. I threaten about writing a memoir on this podcast probably every other episode. Like, I'm going to write this. I finally have to write this story. And then I just don't do it. But I think I need somebody like you to give me a kick in the pants, or at least to help me find what is the heart of my story. What is the story I want to tell?
So yeah. And that, like, memoir writing is emotionally quite hard. I think it's a difficult process to manage. And
especially when a lot of the characters are alive and might not like your memoir.
Oh gosh. Yeah. Oh my goodness. We talk about that a lot. Like we spend a lot of time thinking about the ethics of writing memoir and how to get around, you know, writing stuff about people that might not want to be written about. Like, that's a really important thing. It's really huge, yeah.
All right, so if somebody
and sometimes that's about waiting, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, maybe waiting for them to, yeah.
Yeah,
no longer
there's
be
a lot
around.
Of memoirists out there waiting for someone to die. I mean, exactly. let's be honest here.
All right, so if somebody wants to find out more about those classes, how would they find out?
You can take a look at my website, which is katherine-may.com, and there's a tab at the top that says go to my courses. So I'm taking waitlist members for the nonfiction course yet. It's coming out really soon, but I'm just trying to get it all lined up because I've been so busy. But you can always take the Wintering for Writers course. That's always available.
So, that's wonderful. Yeah. All right. Well, Katherine May, thank you so much for taking the time to talk to me. I find you just endlessly fascinating.
Thank you.
And I recommend
it's been so lovely
books.
To talk to you.
It's wonderful to talk to you, and stay warm.
I tell you what, it's spring is arriving here. So,
oh,
you know, there's great cause for optimism right now.
Thanks so much. Wonderful to talk to you.
It's been really fun. Thank you. I've really loved it.
Thank you so much for listening to Write About Now, hosted by my dad, Jonathan Small. Please leave us a review in your podcast app, share with a friend, or join our online community at writeaboutnowmedia.com. You can send John your questions to his email address, jonathan@writeaboutnowmedia.com. If you're not like super creepy, he may even get back to you. On behalf of John, our cats Seymour and Thatcher, and the Write About Now crew, this is Ella, hoping that you do the right thing.